increase you in the name of one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Welcome to Holy Week. This is the week where we live into our confession that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. This is how we articulate our faith week after week after week. And it's this week, this Holy Week, that we live into it. And we are at the very beginning of that statement of faith, where we begin our days waving our palms, saying, Hosanna in the highest. And then we witness the death of Christ in that very, 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 very long gospel reading. So I'm all out of preach, and I haven't even started. So, but taking our time with this week is so important. Have you ever been in an uncomfortable situation, like if Anthony's preaching or something like that, and you know it's going to go on for a long time, and then you start to writhe in your seat a little bit, as I'm sure all of you were doing just a little bit ago, and then eventually you surrender yourself to that uncomfortable place, and you begin to listen, you begin to be present. As I read this gospel reading, that's exactly what happened to me. I started to focus more on its length and how long it will take and how sore my voice would be at the end of it and how afraid I was that you all would get bored. And then I started to actually listen to the story. And I began to see how sin works according to Luke. How everyone in that story were supposed to be empathetic. Pilate was just doing his job. He knew that Jesus was innocent, but I wonder what the dialogue was in his own mind. This man is innocent, but this crowd's going nuts. Things here are unstable as they've ever been. Revolution is about to break out. If I don't give them this one innocent man, war will surely happen, and many more innocents will happen, or many more innocents will die. I'm going to let this man go. I'm going to wash my hands of it and be done. And Peter, who here wouldn't do what Peter did? To deny Christ three times to save his own skin. I would do that if I'm honest with myself. Where I can stay up late with Jesus and following him all those years. And to have him know that when the time came to stand up for Christ, that I would deny him three times, even before the cock crows in the morning, in order that I may not be crucified next to him. And then Herod. Herod wanted to know Jesus, but he didn't get what he wanted. He was in a position of power, and he was unable to hear the good news. In this story, we see so many different versions of the same sin. Of the accounts of all these different people and the disciples who even on the last night were arguing who was the greatest. They still didn't get it. They had the privilege of walking with Christ that entire time and they still didn't get it. It's not about being regarded as the greatest. It's about serving. It's about being the one to serve as Christ identifies himself and urges us to serve. They all failed to get it. They all missed the mark. But they all found themselves in the shadow of the same cross. They were all guilty of the same very reasonable, very intelligent, very well thought out sin. And it wasn't just Jesus humbled in that shadow of the cross. It was all of them. For even the centurion can see after it was too late that this man surely was innocent, that surely this man was more than just a man. And then we should see ourselves in that as well. Because we all, myself especially, gather together here, not because we are pure, not because we are righteous, but because we are like all of the people in this passion narrative. That we all sin, sometimes without even knowing it. That we're all guilty of something, that we all carry around some pain that we don't need to carry around. There are countless times every week, you know, for very reasonable reasons. I'm exhausted. I have the flu. My attention is somehow broken, and I miss the suffering and the need of others. Sometimes I say things, I have mannerisms that rub people wrong, and then they might carry around that pain and not tell me that I'm doing something wrong. We all do these things. It's the way of the world. We live in a fallen world, and we all come here in that sin, realizing that we are small, that we have spent so much time trying to control our lives and to control the lives of others, to make sense of the world. But we come here humbled, realizing that we are indeed too small. That Jesus died for us, not because we deserve it, but because he loves us. It's Christ's love and grace that brings us here today, that we all are indeed broken. That doesn't mean that God gave up on us. That does not mean that God stopped loving us. It even might mean that God died for us, that Christ died for us and was risen because of that sin, because of that love. That Christ didn't want us to carry around that weight and that pain anymore. And he's inviting us into that grace today. We are at the very beginning of that faith. That Christ has died, that Christ is risen, that Christ will come again. We're at the very beginning of that, where we can realize how short we often fall, how much we cling to our own sin and sense of control, how we cling on to our own hurt feelings, our own pain, and our own anger, and our own self-righteous indignation, rather than offering the grace that we are offered every day. We're at the very beginning of that, in this holy week of Lent. It's in the shadow of the cross that we realize that we are full of sin, but it's also in the shadow of the cross that we realize that grace is offered to us that we cannot even begin to understand. And it's because we have received that grace that we offer to one another.